SIBO diagnoses are on the rise, but what actually is SIBO and what can we do about it? Well, this is what the science says. Small intestinal bacterial overgrowth, or SIBO, is characterized by excessive amounts of bacteria in the small intestines, where it shouldn't be. Symptoms of SIBO are pretty nonspecific, and it makes it difficult to differentiate with symptoms of other GI conditions, such as IBS and food intolerances. They can also vary from mild to severe, depending on the individual, the underlying cause, and the type of the microbial flora involved. In patients affected with SIBO, you'll tend to see symptoms such like bloating, abdominal pain or distension, chronic diarrhea, weight loss, malabsorption and nutrient deficiencies, particularly fat-soluble vitamins, also B12 and iron deficiencies. You can also see things like osteoporosis, fatigue and weakness, and as well neuropathies. So how can you be sure if your patient has SIBO? Thanks to improvements in diagnostic testing, we are now able to better diagnose it. The most common tests available are bacterial cultures, which gather information on the anaerobic and aerobic bacteria counts in the small intestines. There's also breath tests for lactulose or glucose, and blood tests for CDTB and vinculin antibodies. Due to the challenges involved with bacterial cultures, breath tests are actually now the predominant testing method used and a great place to start for diagnosis. During a breath test, patients follow a 1 to 2 week preparatory diet, then drink a glucose or lactulose solution. This solution is meant to feed the bacteria. Breath samples are then collected every 15 to 20 minutes for 2 to 3 hours to measure bacterial gases of hydrogen and methane. If the gases are present during the first 2 hours, this indicates the presence of bacteria in the small intestines and a positive result of SIBO. If the gases are present during the 3rd hour only, bacteria is only present in the large intestines. In order to treat SIBO, we must first look at the risk factors and other factors contributing to the pathogenesis. Inadequate secretion of gastric acid, irritable bowel syndrome, metabolic disorders such as diabetes and hypochlorhydria. Elderly individuals are actually more susceptible. Small intestinal dysmotility and celiac disease and gastroparesis. Poor gut immune function and immunodeficiencies. Anatomic abnormalities of the GI tract such as diverticula and strictures in the small intestines. And also use of certain medications such as recurrent antibiotic use and gastric acid suppressors. There's also things to look for like dysfunction in certain organs such as cirrhosis, renal failure, pancreatitis, celiac disease, or Crohn's disease. Since there are so many possible contributing factors, it is first important to understand which ones are involved in a case-by-case basis, as this could impact your approach to treatment. SIBO treatments generally include a combination of dietary interventions, review of medications, and antimicrobials to address the overgrowth. When treating patients with SIBO, it is so important to identify the underlying cause. Number one, have your patient follow a SIBO-safe diet. While a number of diets exist, they all reduce carbohydrate intake, which is the primary food source for bacteria. The elemental diet aims to starve and eliminate bacteria while providing adequate overall nutrition for the patient. And it involves consuming liquid meal replacements comprised of predigested nutrients for a 2 to 3 week period with no solid foods. The FODMAP diet, FODMAP stands for fermentable oligodimonosaccharides and polyols. These are highly fermentable carbohydrates that can alter the gut microbiota and have been identified as a possible factor contributing to the development of SIBO. There's also the specific carbohydrate diet, otherwise known as SCD, and originally this was developed as a treatment for celiac disease, and it also limits the intake of certain carbohydrates in order to promote a favorable composition of bacteria in the gut. The SCD diet has also shown some promise in the treatment of digestive conditions like IBD. Other diets include Cedar Sinai Low Fermentable Diet, the CSD, the SIBO Specific Food Guide, the SSFG, and the Fast Track Digestion Diet. So number two, correct nutritional deficiencies. Common nutrient deficiencies that may require supplementation include vitamin B12, fat-soluble vitamins like A, D, E, and K, calcium, and magnesium. Number three, address the overgrowth. While the conventional treatment of SIBO typically involves the prescription of antibiotics like neomycin and rifaximin, research has actually shown that certain herbal antimicrobials are as effective without the negative side effects. Rates of SIBO recurrence indicated by positive glucose breath tests also appear to remain high following antibiotic treatment. So these herbal antimicrobials include things like berberine, oil of oregano, neem, and allicin. So not the whole garlic, because that is highly fermentable. And number four, focus on prevention. Prevention of reoccurrence. Follow a low carbohydrate diet, limit stress as much as possible, consume meals 4 to 5 hours apart with a 12-hour overnight fast, use an herbal prokinetic to enhance GI motility, and also visceral manipulation such as abdominal massage can also be very helpful. Now, if you've had experience with treating patients with SIBO, by all means, like this post and comment below, because we're gonna keep this conversation going. And for more information about SIBO and a SIBO protocol, visit Fullscript's Practitioner Medical Education Hub at www.fullscript.com/HCP.